It's a funny way to make ends meet when the lights are out on every street. It feels alright, but never complete.
Jerks.
Nights.
Nights. Gossip.
Hey, girlfriend. What's new?
Things. But you're talking about... Here we go. The wind-up. But you're talking about, like, the sort of faith and religious thing always makes me think of Frank, who I used to work with, when, you know, you've heard me like talk about him before.
He was, which one's he?
Oh, he was, this is a fishing question.
No.
I can't remember. He was a Malaysian Indian guy I worked with.
Oh, was he the guy who used to sing?
No, he never sung.
Oh.
No.
I thought he was the one in, I love you, babe.
No, that was Kenny.
Oh. So you've worked with so many people.
Yeah.
Can't keep track of them.
Oh, Frank was like such a naturally funny guy, but a dipshit at the same time, that you could have him sort of like laugh at and with him simultaneously. Like, you know, at work, they would always have rostered days off and he could never work out when his rostered day off was. And he'd like... have a night off the night he wasn't supposed to and then come into work and he'd be like holding to the office.
Now I know who
a management would like rip shit into him going, where the fuck were you? And he'd like play a racist card at that point, going, you're only giving me a hard time because I'm black. And he'd come out and he'd start mouthing off in front of us, going, they fucking hate the black man, that's why they won't. You go, it's not because you're black, Frank, it's because you're a fucking idiot. You didn't come in the day you were supposed to. But he was right into auras and he was in... you'd never shut him up about his guru in India. He would like take trips like once a year or every couple of years over to India to like visit his guru, and his guru like was also into auras. Yeah, so they'd take this shitty photo of you and it would show up your aura. There would be this like smudgy colour sort of around your head.
Is this like an Amway thing where you can go and get the colours done?
Yeah, exactly.
Would he offer to do your colour?
Like, no, he wouldn't do it. I've
got a Polaroid here, I'll take a photo of you.
Mm. No, he wouldn't, but he like had a photo in his wallet of him that showed his orange aura. And he had like this medallion that he used to wear that was like given to him by his guru. It was like, you know, it was his most treasured fucking item. The thing with Frank, like, he always used to buy secondhand like cheap shit cars. If he had a car, it was worth $500 at the most.
Yeah.
And he used to buy them like that because they'd always get broken into or just stolen from St. Kilda or wherever the fuck he was at the time. And he had one of these occasions, he was driving one of his shit cars, decided to go for a swim. So he's got a park down by the beach.
Yeah.
Melbourne Beach. And he just takes off his medallion, his special medallion that he gets from his guru, puts it into his wallet and just slips it under the car seat.
Oh no.
He goes for a swim. He comes back. The car has been broken into. There's nothing to take in the car except for his wallet, and that's gone.
Who knows, you put in your sneaker and leave it on the beach.
Yeah, yeah. Oh man, when he like came back to work, he was fucking devastated because he lost his wallet. He lost the photo that showed his aura.
And the medallion.
And he lost his special medallion that his guru had done whatever with. Yeah, and he was like depressed for months.
I was going to say, carried around in his ass for 2 years.
Yeah. Like no, I was getting the hand on that medallion. Oh yeah, he was fucking depressed. He would like talk about it at work all the time. Oh, I think my fucking, you know, it was bad luck for him. I think he had enough time in there to actually take another trip back to India and speak to his guru about it. And his guru had to like settle him down, and he came back and he was all still.
He'd probably been busy emailing for months, and the guru go, "Oh, yeah, get shut up. So yeah. Over here, yeah. We'll do this yeah. little candle thing."
I got boxes of them.
Yeah. Pulls another one out of his ass. Here you go. You're alright.
But he came back, yeah, he's still bummed out. But then he must have got the phone call in the afternoon because because he came into work and he was like fucking stoked and like let us know that he got the phone call from this woman. Now, I don't know how this worked, whether the police just gave her his number or what the fuck. But anyway, this like woman had called him to say that someone had thrown a bag, like a duffel bag, over her fence that was just full of wallets.
It was probably the car thief's mother or something.
And she'd gone through them and just called everybody that she could. And like he had a phone number and all that sort of shit in there. The money was gone, blah, blah, blah. And he didn't really care at this point. But, you know, he was able to ask her, oh, is the medallion still in the wallet, in the photo? And she said, oh, yeah, like, they're both there. And, you know, it fucking just made his day. Goes, yeah, fucking, it's such a good sign. So, yeah, he'd come into work, fucking told everybody, going, I got the phone call. I'm going to get the medallion back, going, you know, I knew, you know, the shit couldn't work out that bad. I'm gonna get that there had to be a reason for it all, and this is so such like a good sign to be.
Guru's probably set all this up.
yeah.
Got in touch with the woman again. Listen, I'm sending in this thing.
Yeah.
Do me a favor, give this guy
give
a call.
Give us how to call, will ya? And then
get him off my back.
Yeah, so he'd made plans that he was gonna like go and see her on the weekend, which he did, and he got the wallet back, got his medallion back. But then when like he came into work the next week, he was still pumped, but there was no medallion and stuff. And as he explained to us, they're going, oh, look, it's not, because it was stolen, because it was in the hands of a criminal, it like picked up bad energy, and that he had to cleanse the medallion.
It's metal known for its porous qualities.
Yeah. Yeah. It's like cheap fucking gold plated lead. soaks in the bad vibes. Yeah, he had to cleanse it and it would be like ready in like 2 weeks. So he went through this process of like putting the medallion sort of on the windowsill, so when the sun came up, the sun could shine on it, cleanse it, and then like during the night he would light candles around it. The moon could shine on it and shit, and the candles were meant to fucking get the bad vibes out.
Well, that doesn't sound good.
No, it doesn't sound good, because it's the thing that always cracks me up. Like, because he'd been crapping on about how this was a sign and this was so perfect, blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
But then fuckhead, yeah, he's got it on the windowsill at night with the candles burning. The fucking curtain blows over the candle.
He didn't think to shut the window. Oh, you've got to get the moon piece coming in.
Yeah. And
they can get into metal, but they can't go through glass.
Yeah. And while fucking Dick Wank is asleep like in his on the lounge or whatever, his house catches fire.
Oh.
And burns the whole fucking kitchen and like half the house down.
Oh, it's a wonder he escaped.
Yeah.
His luck couldn't have been that bad.
It was.
Oh. Also very relaxed, lying down. I'm forgetting you. Lie down in any chair. Some ornate carver lying across with your knees up on one armrest. Back sticking in the other.
Yeah. I love to sit in class with my feet on the fucking desk. Get told off.
Miss, Mike's lying down his chair again. Now he's looking at me. I came here to get a good education, and how will I go to a good college?
Dawn Davenport. We should be the ones teaching. They don't know nothing.
Dawn has eaten a hoagie. I've still got that in my head. Somebody loves you.
It's been in my head all day.
Oh, can't get enough of it.
Oh, don't talk about the 80s.
I thought we were talking about the 80s. No, we're talking about the 90s.
No, it just gives me that like bad. I know you like love hearing me talk about that bad primary school experience of where my like when my teacher wanted to do the performance of Grease. Somehow she was like fucking way too young to be like doing that sort of shit anyway, but we were gonna like do on
Grease is pretty seedy.
Oh, was it Grease? No, I think it might have been West Side Story or some shit like that.
Oh, that's even worse.
Yeah, I know, it's even worse. And then
this little primary schoolers pretending to be gangbangers and...
But then she looked into it and then, like, sort of found out that... she was, like, this, like, burnt-out hippie from the fucking 60s. She was terrible. She was, like, the worst teacher I ever had in school. That she wouldn't teach... Like, she'd have, like, a lesson plan and just scrap the whole thing and sort of, like, spend the whole day telling you this big anecdote of how she was like finger banged by Billy Thorpe and all the Aztecs.
No way.
Oh, it was, yeah, it was bad.
Oh, no.
Yeah, you'd be sitting
there. How old were you? This is primary school.
Like 10, 11, yeah.
You'd be
sitting there like going, I think I should be getting an education. Why the fuck am I listening to this story? I remember like this one. Yeah, the time I really sort of like, it's not like I was like oblivious to it beforehand, but yeah. I distinctly remember like sitting there going, what the fuck are we doing? Like, is when we're not learning lessons or anything. She's just telling us about how she used to date this like killer surfer and,
as in, he was a really good surfer.
Yeah, he was a good surfer.
He wasn't a murderer or anything.
No, he was a good surfer, and she like lived in this share house, like at the beach somewhere, and they just do bong hits.
Oh my god!
Yeah, and she met this guy, who was older. He was in his 30s.
Yeah.
And he introduced himself as a warlock, and she believed that he was a warlock.
Oh, no.
Because he could do this, like, what sealed the deal for her is that he could do this, like, chin-up sort of, like, flip from the gutter on the veranda onto the roof. And she's going, oh, I was on so many drugs at that point. I just, like, thought it was for real. I thought he was a warlock. I remember sitting there.
And you were 10.
Yeah, sitting there
and
going.
So she's like she's your classroom teacher. It's not like you. It's not like in high school where it's like, well, we're going to be in there for an hour and a half. We're going to hear this anecdote, man.
No.
So I remember having a graphics teacher like that. But you'd, and as a kid, you'd be going, can we just draw something? Because he was like still scarred from the war. He would tell. He would tell stories
which
about the
war.
Oh, I was going to say the Boer War, but I think he was in the Air Force. But yeah, he would just, Mr. Phillips, he would just drone on and on. He would wear a grey suit.
Mm.
He was one of the, like, the only other teacher that wore a suit was the principal. And he would, he was an old school, and he was an old school draftsman. And now for some reason he was teaching. And that was the point when we realized there are some teachers that are doing this just for a crust and they're hanging out for retirement.
Mm.
Because you would have kids that would, any other teacher that might, you know, muck around and be told to, you know, sit down or occasionally get out. They would be the kids putting up their hands and going, Mr. Phillips, can we draw something now? Because he would drone on and on about his war experiences. Oh. And they weren't good entertaining war experiences.
You're talking about just putting a bayonet through someone's head or something.
Oh, you wish. I think it was just talking about, you know, sitting around waiting for a mission and the boredom and how we sat around and cried and I don't know.
The only time I ever heard a decent story out of this teacher was when she must have been, I don't know what was wrong with her, but she told this story about how as a little kid, you know, she'd watch plenty of cartoons, you know, that had definitely have Roadrunner and Coyote, sort of like laws of physics.
And then one day she discovered Daddy's special cartoons?
No. Oh. She decided that she would tie a rope to the back of the car.
Oh, I thought it was going to be worse. Like to little brother or something.
No. Tie a rope to the back of the car and then tie it to herself. And the car would drive off. And then she would like sort of just, you know, like wave in the wind behind the car. That's what she wanted to do. So she ties a rope to the car and then ties it to herself. She hides in the shed. Her dad comes in, like hops in the car and sort of like just drives off. Doesn't know that she's tied to a rope, tied to the back of the car.
You generally look
checking
the rear view mirror, do the walk around, check your tires, check to see if your kid's tied herself to the car.
Yeah, so he goes for a drive like with this, I don't know how old she was, like a 7-year-old or whatever, like tied to a fucking car, just dragging along the road before someone is able to like, stop and flag him down.
She's banging her head repeatedly. Yeah. That can't be good for her future life.
Yeah, as a school teacher. That was the only story I ever heard from her. I'm just sitting there just laughing my ass off. You're a fucking idiot.
I remember you telling me about this idiot teacher, but I always thought of her as some, she's too young, she's immature kind of thing. I didn't think that of her as a, like, the burnt-out hippie type.
No, she wasn't really burnt-out hippie. When I say, like, burnt-out hippie, it wasn't 70s. It was definitely, like, monkey grip, sort of, like, early 80s sort of era. Like, the late 70s, early 80s is when she was off the hook. And it was all crazy. Yeah. Like, puberty blues.
Yeah.
Sort of shit with her. And that's why, like, yeah, she wanted to put on this musical, but she found out that it was going to cost her money to put on West Side Story or anything like that.
A lot of money.
Yeah, a lot of money. So then she decides that she's going to just write her own musical.
For a bunch of 10-year-olds.
Yeah.
Oh.
And so you could virtually just wipe out a whole 8 months of the fucking school year as... That is the only thing that's like...
That you're working on.
Yeah. Is this fucking stupid...
Is there no reporting or anything going on in that school?
Obviously not.
Oh, no kids go to fess up.
Yeah, it was fucking terrible. It was awful.
You're the class that everyone wanted to be in.
No. No way. And she eventually writes this thing. You know, as a 10-year-old, I couldn't keep track of the shitty story. It was something about this. You could tell it was her, like, she was writing out her life story as a musical. It was about this teenage girl who lived in a boring suburban family, and the mum and dad didn't, like, love each other enough. And the teenage girl wanted to like experience life and be a rebel, and the parents like, you know, wanted to try and keep her down and not let her do it, but instead she goes out and like
writes a musical.
Yeah. Yes, just one. So it's like a every musical cruising in a circle. Yeah.
Oh.
Oh no. She experiences life, and you know she turns out fucking awesome, shit hot, and all at once.
Kids, very exciting. I've got the finger banging scene down pat.
Yeah, it was this very like weak, thin story, and every like 30 seconds, she would just It was just some song that was in the charts 7 years prior to that that she loved would just like play.
Did she put alternative lyrics to it?
No, it was just a song. It was just
so she's not exactly writing a musical at this stage.
No, it was just little bits and pieces in between her fucking mixtape. I just remember like the big showstopper for her. Her high point was Coup d'etat's Too Young for Promises.
Favorite song of all the 10-year-olds.
Oh, it was bad, and it was and it was in the scene as it was being acted out. You had the girl standing like in the middle. And on one side, you had the boring conservative parents. And on one side, you had the tearaway kids. And they're grabbing either arm and sort of like...
doing the tug of war.
Pulling it backwards and forwards. And she's got to make the choice between being a fucking boring fucker. Oh, it was...
Make it stop.
It was so hideous. I was like, I was old enough to just go... God, this is the biggest piece of train wreck shit ever.
Loving it?
Oh, yeah. Loving it. Just how bad it was. Yeah, and how much of an idiot she was. I fucking lucked out.
I'm forgetting that now you're a kid that grew up in GTS, BKN.
I was lucky that I got to be a character. I had to give the very first line in it. I was like this business dude... having breakfast in the first scene. All I had to do was to sort of eat my breakfast, look at my watch and go, I'm late for work, stand up, kiss my wife goodbye, walk out the door, and I was
done. And that's it.
I was done.
Oh,
that was it. So I was out of that fucking...
Did you wrangle that part specifically?
I think she probably gave it to me on purpose. Like, go
no, you just gotta fuck around if you're on stage for longer.
Get this toxic asshole out of this play. It's about me and my dreams. Yeah, the worst.
So, did you end up performing in front of the school?
Yeah, they performed it.
Was it at assembly or was it a special night?
No, it was at assembly. It was this, you know, this.
Did she dress up for it? It was like a big gala morning.
Oh, yeah. Oh, it was costumed and everything.
Yeah.
Yeah. It was
and
in
you know no one's going to take it seriously because assembly, just sit there for a little bit, then you go off to class. There's no excitement over assembly.
Yeah, I sort of just remember the principal and vice principal just standing there just like, just watching this garbage. Meanwhile, there was another teacher who was roughly the same age as her.
Yeah.
And a fucking dropkick, early 80s burnout as well. Like, she was somehow involved in the project. She's like loving it. But it was also a competitive thing too. That my teacher had written and put on a musical at the school to like put her friend to up the ante, like her co-worker, you know, had to do something better. It was fucking terrible.
So did the co-worker care?
What
am I saying? You were 10.
Yeah, you I don't know. I can't remember. Yeah.
I thought maybe the other teacher was, you'd say your line, then go backstage, and then she'd start bitching about how much she hated the teacher that wrote the musical.
Yeah. No, that sort of thing would happen. We'd have lessons in the classroom of where our teacher would just bitch out the other about the other teacher.
Oh,
you go, oh, we're hilarious. Not learning anything. All we're here, like I remember having to sit there and listen to our teacher complain about the other teacher of going, and I'll tell you another thing, Miss So-and-so is such a fuck, well, she didn't say drop an F-bomb, going, she's a liar and a hypochondriac. She tried to tell us, all the other teachers, that she's got this rare medical condition and that every 3 weeks she has to undergo a complete blood transfer. As if that happens, there's no way. Like, go, I don't know if I should be hearing this, hearing these stories.
No, I don't think I should even be attending this.
Yeah, school. Can we go back to actually trying to like learn some mathematics or something? No, she was the worst.
Which one? Both of them.
Yeah. No.
What made it really uncomfortable was the composite class. Bitch face. Right here. Yeah, well, you don't have to elbow me.
Yeah. She was just on work experience. She was a student teacher in the classroom at the time.
So is she now working for up at NIDA or
who knows where she is?
Dead in a ditch.
I hope so. I hated her. She'd make me work outside the classroom.
Because you just got on her nerves. Or did you deserve it? Maybe a little.
Maybe a little bit.
Yeah, because you dared to say, we should be learning, you should be doing a job.
Oh, yeah. It was good though. I'd work in a little alcove thing at the top of the flight of stairs. Great, I'd just sit there at my desk, no one in the classroom.
So you had a little office yourself?
Yeah.
Was that every class you would just go to, she'd mark roll and you go, okay.
Yep.
Walk out, take my desk. Really?
Yeah. No, my desk was there at the top of the flight of stairs. So I'd just sit in the stairwell.
I know you've mentioned about having to sit on the steps. I thought it was just like, go on, get out of the room, time out.
No, I'd sit at a desk at the top of the stairs.
So there must have been an arrangement in the school, because, like, the principal's obviously not walking through. What's this desk doing here? It's like, Yeah,
I'd...
They know that there's no way that this year is going to go without imploding if you're in the classroom.
Yeah.
With this crazy...
Yeah, I'd sort of... It had come unraveled like during creative writing processes, all I would do is just write stories about dismembering her or and then there'd be a kerfuffle and go, well, this time I'll write a recipe and I'd write the method out, and the method would involve like cutting her up.
Oh, and... no.
Yeah.
And I love that the solution is to give you a desk in the hallway.
Well, the first thing was to like bring my family in, and then the second thing was to send me.
They said, no, this is good literature, leave the boy alone.
Yeah, the second thing was to send me out of the classroom to a therapist. And then, after that, I didn't have...
The therapist goes, actually, you've got a good point.
Yeah.
This is how you should make the story go.
Yeah, no, then I went to, then I didn't have to do, sort of schoolwork after that. I was when I just got to, like, cook things or just,
what do whatever. What, you work in the canteen?
No, I remember, like, yeah,
they
just...
They fast track you into the workforce.
Yeah. They just used to let me, someone from the school would like go to the supermarket and pick up things. I would just like tag along, just go to the supermarket.
Because then they don't have a job to do at the school.
Yeah.
No one's teaching. No one's answering phones.
Yeah. I'd just cook things. Like I'd cook fucking chicken chow mein for the teachers. And they could all have some on their lunch break. And they'd tell me how great it was.
This is the most awesome school.
Yeah.
Terrifying, but awesome.
Mm. But eventually they made me go back to the class.
Because they fired her?
No, oh. She was there. No, that's when I got my... Yeah, that's when I wasn't in the same classroom as everybody else. Because I went back to the same teacher. I just got to sit in the stairwell.
Well, you're allowed to go back to class. Why, by class, we mean...
Sit in the stairwell by yourself. Yeah.
You can sit in the janitor's cupboard.
Because somehow I was like, yeah, too scary, too frightening for her. It's good. All I did was just draw pictures out in the stairwell. I painted a picture of a dolphin in a desert.
Which isn't a stretch since you grew up in the desert.
That was actually a turning point between the relationship of the teacher and myself. That
she liked dolphins.
Yeah.
She understood the metaphor.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I painted a picture of the desert and I did a picture of a dolphin like doing a flip in the desert. And she added touched her.
Speech balloon says too young for questions.
Too young for promises.
Promises.
Coup d'etat. She loved it. That was like a big thing for her, yeah. And it got pinned up like in the classroom, sort of at the front. And we had like a panel type thing of where her and I sat on stools sort of at the front of the class and just sort of shot the shit.
I just
talked about the artwork.
It's like it's not just that you're let back into the classroom going, all right, you can, you know, we're okay, you can rejoin us. You come back as a star.
I didn't rejoin the classroom.
You're a featured guest.
Yeah, I was a guest.
And coming up, we have Mark from the hallway.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I was. I went back to the hallway. But at that point, there was like, there was more of a, artist in residence, like working relationship at that point. That she would come out and tell me what was needed and stuff.
These fuckers can't draw. We need you. Can you do a camel?
Yeah,
the ocean.
Yeah, I think the two of us like worked out like we drafted up some big
set for her next musical.
Yeah, no, it was like it was on a big banner, some big painting that we painted. Yeah. Oh, we painted a picture. Her and I like worked out the design for a painting that we put on the fence of the cemetery.
Did the council know about it?
Yeah, we got permission. It was a
picture. It wouldn't surprise me if she just decided to go and do it. No one was expecting her to do this musical at the assembly. She just turns up with these kids in costume.
Yeah, they hung there for years. We were both a little bit upset about the execution because it was painted by the shitty students in her class. I remember the two of us.
But they gave you something to bitch together in the staff room over.
Yeah. Yeah. The hell was it done properly?
That's such a fucked up primary school experience.
Oh, it was bad.
That is mind-boggling.